Welcome back to this I24 News Evening edition. I'm Lucy Arish, and this is the Daily Debate. Last Thursday, a Russian man was killed by what Russian media described as a man of non-Slavic appearance. The murder sparked a protest which quickly turned violent and saw the arrest of nearly 400 people. Joining me tonight is Baruch Ben-Neria, former Israeli ambassador to Georgia and Armenia. Thank you very much for coming.
Good evening.
And Amit Kling.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you very much for coming to our studio from our I-24 News Morning Edition reporter. Welcome you both. But before we will start the discussion here, let's hear the latest from our Moscow correspondent, Ilan Gohan, who's joining us right now in Skype. Hello, Ilan.
Good evening, Lucy.
So what is the latest developments about what is going on right now in Russia?
Well, Moscow police is tonight out in force in the southern Moscow district of Biolalova. Special units, anti-riot police, and officers of the immigration services. After what we have seen today was quite an astonishing raid by the Moscow police on the market that was attacked yesterday. Basically, they've rounded up and arrested 1,200 migrants working in this vegetable warehouse and in the surroundings. And this place was basically raided by a mob. There's no other way to describe it. A group of people of local residents and white supremacists, extreme right-wingers, Russians, they attacked this market yesterday, claiming that the assailant, the murderer of this Russian young man last Thursday, came from within this market and a nearby commercial center. They claim that it must be a person from the North Caucasus or Central Asia, even though we still haven't seen or heard actually any details about the assailant. That's what the streets in Moscow demanded yesterday. And in a, I think, pretty telling move, the mayor, Sobyanin, current mayor, incumbent mayor in Moscow, who is a close ally of the Kremlin, said tonight that, of course, he does not condone any violence against migrants, but he will continue with raids and arrests of illegal migrants in Moscow, while most of the assailants, most of the people who were arrested tonight, are already freed.
So, you know, nobody's talking about racism there. Nobody's talking about, except the media, nobody's talking about, we just heard about the last few weeks, we've been reporting about what's happening against gays' rights in Russia. So this is not the last or the only case against certain people or a certain kind of people that Russia is coming, people in Russia are going out against.
I think we need to distinguish this from the issue of the anti-gay propaganda or ban on gay propaganda, as it is known. But it is part of the system that the Kremlin uses to sort of distance itself from elements that it deems dangerous to its reign. In the case of illegal migrants, this was used very widely by both the incumbent mayor in Moscow, Sobyanin, and his opponent, the opposition leader Navalny. Both of them attacked migrant workers. Both of them said that illegal migrants or even people who hold a Russian passport are to blame basically for any problem in the Russian society, the lack of proper jobs, crime and violence on the streets. And of course, this thing resonates with certain parties, with certain organizations in Russia. On the other hand, it has to be noticed that there is a problem in certain areas of Moscow where people just are just afraid to go out at night. This is also an issue that needs to be addressed.
Ilan Gohan, our I-24 News correspondent in Moscow, thank you very much for this. Gentlemen, thank you again for coming to the studio. We heard what Ilan said, so he's saying no connections about let's put the gay rights aside, let's put the migrants' rights aside, but we are talking about a very, very dark way of thinking, Mr. Ben-Neria.
Traditionally, Moscow is overcrowded by immigrants all over the former Soviet Union, especially from Central Asia, from Caucasus, and especially from Georgia. There's a big community from Georgia in Moscow. It's more than 500,000. From Armenia, Azerbaijan, part of the Chechens, and so on. And of course, from Central Asia, as I said. All these inhabitants, all this population, it was, since the collapse of the Soviet Union, was overcrowded the city, and it was overtaken the whole what we call the market system of the city, and they are ruling the all this, and they are handling the whole this marketing with the warehouse where the average income or everyday income is $40 million per day, and when you double it in for a year, there's an enormous sum of money is going on these places. So, and this neighborhood, which was the riot started, is a very poor neighborhood. There was one of the poorest neighborhood of Russia, of Moscow. So this clash between these people who are foreigners and these local people with what they call a national pride of them, that was after this assassination, murder of some kind of a citizen there, that sparked all these riots and mass.
I'm hearing you, and I'm hearing what you're saying, and I cannot not find the connection to World War II, when between the Jews, when you know the Germans claimed about the Jews that they're taking their jobs and they're taking incomes, and this is something that is very worrying, I have to say.
It is, but it's nothing new to a degree, because in a more maybe abstract way of putting it, the collapse of the Soviet Union created a lot of vacuums in society. And there is a vacuum in the market system, which has been overtaken by a lot of criminal elements, as Mr. Benary just said. And also, on the more social level, there's a sort of an identity vacuum. And a lot of the younger generation has turned to rather extreme forms of nationalism, which, if examined, is often strange. I mean, you see all kinds of odd symbols, like a movement called the National Bolsheviks, who combine a sort of admiration for the Bolsheviks, the communists, and also for a sort of a neo-Nazi movement. And their actual symbol is the hammer and the sickle, mm-hmm. inside, positioned like a swastika. So just think about that symbol. Think about this. It looks like something from an alternative history movie. Yes. It's something from The Men of the High Castle.
Of course. So we're talking about youngsters, like you said, that are going to a nationalistic way of thinking, nationalism way of thinking, which is very surprising, I have to say. Why? Because what is the difference? Is it a different education that these young people are getting? Is it a different way of thinking? Is it a different culture than what we know, or what we grew up on?
No, I'm sorry. The performance of these skinheads, whatever, on these neo-Nazis movements, it's quite new in Russia. It's not a very old one, because during the communist regime, there was no neo-Nazis at all. And even they suppressed all kinds of nationalism in Soviet Union. But after the collapse, all kind of organization and movements, which is a copy of the West, started to appear in the new Russia. But if you take Germany, there's a lot of people who support the neo-Nazi party in Germany. Take the Scandinavian states, they also have a neo-Nazi movements, and say in the United States we have a Nazi party, and so on and so on. But the problem was how the regime or the government and Putin handled with these movements.
He
tried to suppress them. That's what I'm trying to tell, but it's very difficult, approach, how to suppress them, how to minimize their activity. That's the problem of Russia, because using force, police force, military force, it doesn't make sense, because Russia and Putin have to perform himself now in front approaching the Olympic Games, Winter Olympic Games in January, February, 1914, in a few months. He has to show to the world that Russia is stable, is possible to create the atmosphere like in Beijing before the Olympic Games take place held in Beijing.
But actually, for the last headlines that we have been reporting on for the last few weeks, Russia is not showing that at all about everything that has to do with gay rights and preventing them from having their own children. How are they going actually to try to present to the world that they're so-called open?
You know, PR always works. And there are always, I'm sure there are very good professionals at stake. But even think, I mean, yes, there isn't a sort of a general attempt of suppression, but it's also, you know, there's an old Russian expression, I think it's Turgenev, he said that the severity of Russian law is compromised by the fact that you don't really have to follow it. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, I mean, you see, there have been 400 arrests have been made Thursday. Almost all of them have already been set free. There are 72 criminal cases open. I'm assuming it's against the one they caught so red-handed, they could do nothing about them. And also, there was a police raid on the market. And they arrested 1,200 illegal immigrants. Now, I am not saying, I'm not entering even the topic of, you know, how to deal with immigrants. That's not the case. They have law. Okay, they have laws. The police do what they do. But the timing of such an act coming right after racial riots against those immigrants is sending out a message that, okay, this thing that you're doing is working. Carry on.
But I'm sorry to compare it with the same riots, almost the same riots that occurred in London a few years ago, or in Paris, or in Greece, or even in Israel, in Tel Aviv, against all these Sudans and whatever, Eritrea, immigrants which crossed the border and appeared suddenly in the poorest, Neved Sedek, or whatever, Shkonat HaTikva, which we know very well. This is the same situation where the poorest population of the country or of the city, the metropolis suffered from the misgiving of the government. You see, this was happened in the same thing in Moscow, more or less. Of course, on this there were revival of waves of extreme nationalism, because the Russians during the last decades became more and more nationalist because of this atmosphere of the revival of Russian nationalism or Russian, Russian tradition and even Russian church. So everything together with the leading of Putin, with his special way of as a leader, makes all this situation.
But the difference is, what sort of a message do you send regarding civil disobedience? Because I remember the riots in South Tel Aviv, like 2 years ago, and I agree that, you know, there's a huge problem of the area being neglected. That's a whole different story. But the thing is that after the riots were suppressed, and they were suppressed rather, you know, with little harm to everybody involved. There was relatively little damage done all around. And afterwards, the Yassam didn't step in and arrest 500 immigrants. And even if, you know, I don't want to enter the debate of how to deal with illegal immigrants, but the thing is that, do you send out a message of, if you riot, you will get what you want?
No, I don't think. It depends on the leadership, the political leadership of Russia. They can give up some and give some rights to the demonstrators and so on, yeah, and to release some demonstrators, but they can also detain them and imprison them for many years. This depends on what was the calculation of the political leadership of Russia. What's the concrete political situation?
Can you tell me in one sentence what is the political calculation about migrants in Russia?
Yes.
Is it going to change after this?
I believe yes, because there are too many of them, and it was inconvenient for the leadership, and because they are the public protest against them, because some of these publics, so inhabitants of Moscow, somehow suffering from these immigrants. And they always criticized the government and the authorities, why they allow them to be in Moscow. So the authorities have to react and to create some different atmosphere, different change.
Gentlemen, thank you very much, Baruch Ben-Neria. Thank you very much. And Amitai Kling, thank you very much for coming to our studio. And thank you, our viewers. We're not going out just yet. Just an update from our news desk. And then we're back after 10 minutes with a very special interview with Ravit Kahlani. Yaman Blues, do you know? You will.